we should look at the entire historical evidence that we have, cross-country evidence. And again, if you look at a broad set of companies and comparing how much they pay their manager, you know, if you believe that companies paying their manager 10 million instead of one create more jobs, you know, please show me the evidence. Because when you do it, things at a micro level, you know, comparing countries and drawing conclusion by comparing countries, you know, is difficult. But you, when you compare companies, you know, I can tell you, you don't see the extra performance. But, you know, it's fine
to
have an open debate.
At what point do you think punitive tax rates would deter people from further investment, innovation, economic commitment?
You know, again,
90%, 95%? Are you saying that, you know, that there is almost no tax limit to the top rate of tax for the richest people?
Well, the problem is that there's no limit to the income that they are setting for themselves either. So, you know, there are two, you know, boundless process and, you know, you have to find your way. Okay, let me, you know, tell you that, we you know, I understand it's very difficult to have a quiet debate about money and taxations because people get very excited. So, you know, what I'm trying to put into this debate is, you know, some historical evidence. So let me give you a piece of historical evidence. You know, between 1930 and 1980, you know, the top income tax rate in the United States on average was 82%. And this was during half a century. You know, this is not during a few years. Well, apparently, American capitalism did not disappear. Why is it so? Well, because this was applied only to income above $1 million, $2 million. And, you know, if anything, the growth performance, and in particular productivity growth, innovation, was higher in the 50s, 60s, 70s, that it has been since the 1980s. So, you know, since the 1980s, you see rising inequality everywhere except in the growth statistics.